Afternoon on. Welcome to our seventh session. Today we are having a topic on communication, continuation of communication session. So we can start with sir's presentation. We can have it around 40 to 45 minutes followed by 15 minutes of discussion. By 4 o'clock we can start have our case presentation followed by its discussion. We can wind up our session by 4:30. Thank you all for joining in. Over to Sunil.
Good afternoon. So today we have second part of the communication session. You already know Dr. Biju Raghavan, who is the consultant in pain and palliative medicine at Rajagiri Hospital in Alua. In this session, he will try to handle two topics on communicating bad news and how to manage collusion. And if time permits, he will go on. These are two very important topics, and I hope you will enjoy this session. So it's over to you, Vijay.
Thank you, Sunil, and thank you, Rajalakshmi. As always, it's a pleasure being part of the PALIM India's ECHO educational program, and we at Rajagiri Hospital through our telemedicine program find great pleasure in collaborating with ECHO and PALIM India, and welcome everybody for joining in this session. And without much ado, we'll straight away start the presentation. So today we are going to talk about communicating bad news. Please note that nowadays we are using the term communicating bad news. Earlier we used to call it breaking bad news. And breaking bad news seems a bit more violent, and whereas communicating bad news is actually a very gentle procedure. So instead of breaking, we are communicating. Next, we have to understand these two premises before we can proceed further. That is, the patients have the right to know, and the patients also have the right not to know. That means if a patient wants to know, they have the right to know. Similarly, if the patient does not want to know, they have a right not to know. Next. Go on. Yeah. So all over the world, some models of how to communicate bad news are followed. In many of the developed countries of the West, North America, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, etc., where the patient's autonomy is considered to be sacred. In those kind of environments, the bad news is communicated directly to the patient. And it is only with the permission of the patient that the medical professional can communicate with the family. Because in those countries, it is the patient's right to know, and you cannot divulge any of the patient's information to anybody else, even to the family members, without the patient's permission. So in those kind of countries, the model that is usually practiced is full disclosure model. That is, any patient who comes to meet the doctor, that is, if you were working in, let's say, one of those countries. So if a patient comes to you, you will have to disclose the full information to the patient. Now, we have talked about the two premises. So in this kind of a model where you have to disclose the full information to the patient, what about a patient who does not want to know? So in that kind of situation, there is no choice for a patient who does not want to know. They have to know and then, you know, proceed with it. Whereas in our environment, most of the developing and underdeveloped countries, most of the Asian and Oriental cultures, the patient is not told the bad news. It is usually the family which is told about the bad news. This is how we in India practice. We usually do not talk to the patient, we talk to the family. Now the reason for that is, traditionally in our culture, the patient's autonomy or the individual's rights is always subservient to the rights of the family. In our culture, the patient does not come to us, the family brings the patient to us. And as a result, the family's rights are considered much higher than the patient's or the individual's right, the patient's autonomy. Hence, in our culture, we don't respect patient's autonomy as much as it is respected in other cultures. As a result, our usual practice is we communicate bad news to the family and not to the patient. Now, the problem with this kind of a model is this violates the one of the premises that the patient has the right to know. And in our practice, when the patient and the family comes to us and we have to communicate the bad news, usually we will ask the patient to please go out of the room so that we can talk to the family. And please remember, the patient who is standing outside the room knows that we are talking about him or her, and it is not a good news. That is why the patient has been asked to go out. So the person standing outside knows that something serious is going on, but that person does not have the right to know in our culture. So we violate one of the premise, one of the principle of the patient's right to know. So what this shows is that of the prevailing models of full disclosure or non-disclosure or partial disclosure, all of them have a flaw that it violates one or the other premise. That is, the patient has the right to know and the patient has the right not to know. So one of these premises will be violated in the current models that we practice across the world. Next slide. So question is, what do we do? Next slide. The answer to what do we do is a totally different kind of model of communicating bad news, and that is the individualized disclosure model. Individualized disclosure model. It is that you tailor make a model for each individual. It is like when you go to a ready-made clothes shop and you buy a ready-made dress, you don't wear it straight off the shelf. You give it to the tailor to make some alteration to fit you. So that is your individualizing a piece of cloth to fit you. Similarly, we have to have a model which fits the person who's the patient sitting in front of you. So each person is different, and based on what each person wants, whether the patient wants to know or doesn't want to know. And if the patient doesn't want to know, then how do we proceed? If the patient wants to know, then we have to find out how much the patient wants to know and only serve only that much that the patient wants to know. So this is how the basic structure of an individualized disclosure model will be. Next slide. So before we go on to how to communicate bad news using the individualized disclosure model, we have to find out who should communicate bad news. Please remember, doctors do not automatically qualify to be the communicators, because these are the three important criteria for a person who is the ideal person to communicate bad news. That is, the person who communicates bad news should have the trust of the patient. It's not necessary that we as doctors automatically have the trust of the patient. Perhaps the patient trusts his or her friend, or maybe somebody in the family. But we have to make an effort to be trustworthy, and good communication skills helps us earn the trust of the patient. And we have talked about some of the good communication skills during our last session. The second important criteria is information. And here, as medical professionals, we can claim that we have information. But our biggest handicap is we have this information in the medical jargon, and many of us convey the information to the patient or the family in medical jargon, which does not help. So our inability to speak a normal people's language is our biggest handicap. So we have to learn, or rather unlearn, to speak in medical jargons and learn to speak in normal people's language. The third important criteria is the skill to communicate bad news. We should know the technique, the technology, the standard operating procedure of how to communicate bad news. Remember, communicating bad news is a procedure in communication skills. It is an elective procedure, and like any other elective surgery or elective procedures, we have to set a time and a place for it. And there is an indication for communicating bad news, and there is a standard operating procedure for communicating bad news. There is an expected outcome of communicating bad news, and there is a follow-up method after communicating bad news. Next slide. Now, this is the important part of why bad news should be communicated. I want to all of you to just go through the four important points. I'll explain them. When we know that our life is limited, we will know it only if somebody tells us. Otherwise, we may not know. But when we know that our life span is limited because of a bad disease, an advanced disease, of course, initially, it may be mind-numbing. We may not be able to think properly. We may go through phases of denial, anger, bargaining, acceptance, going again back to denial, anger, etc. But finally, a time comes where we learn to come to terms with the reality that our lifespan is limited. Now, it helps if we know it as early as possible, not when we are in the very end stages of our life. So if somebody were to tell it us as early as possible, we go through the initial storm of emotions, of denial, anger, etc., etc. And after some time, things settle down, we come to terms with it, and then we will think of what I need to do. What do I need to finish? What do I need to accomplish before I die? It may be related to settling the financial issues in the family, telling your spouse the bank password number. It may be related to setting up a will. It may be related to you wanting to do certain things, give certain instructions to certain people within the family and outside. It may be related to that you wanted to visit some places or visit some people. It may be related to forgiving somebody for a bad relationship. It may be asking for forgiveness. It may be indulging in some of the things that you always wanted to do, but have been stopping yourself. For example, if you are a diabetic and not taking laddus for 30 years, you may want to take a laddu now. And so on and so forth. There's a lot of things that one may want to do, accomplish, finish, and mend relationships. or enhance relationships and seek out and do things that you always wanted to do before your mind and body becomes so weak that you are not able to. So all of these things will be part of closure of one's life. The life's business closure, that can happen if only if somebody tells you that you have limited lifespan. And the earlier we know, the better, because we'll get time to go through the emotional storm and then to, you know, reach a calm stage where we can then decide what to do. And that was the first point. The second point is, many a times we see that the patient does not know, the family has been informed, and the family says, okay, then there's no point staying in the hospital, so we are taking the person home. And in the home, then the patient starts complaining that I am not getting better, you take me to the hospital. So the family brings the patient back to the hospital. And in the hospital, we will tell the family, but we told you that there is no point bringing the patient back to us. The family will beg us and says, please keep him here for 1 week and then we will take him away. And these kind of things goes on. So hopping from home to hospital, back to hospital to home, etc., etc. After some time, what happens is the patient starts losing faith in us, because we are not able to reach up to the patient's expectation, because the patient expectation is not according to the reality of the patient. There's a reality expectation mismatch. So because we are not able to reach the patient's expectation, the patient loses trust and faith in us, in what we are doing for the patient. And as a result, the patient may say, take me some other place, take me to so-and-so hospital, in some other town, in some other city, or in some other state. And then the family is forced to take the patient to another place, even though they know that there is no benefit to it. But they have to do, because the patient does not know, and the patient demands to be taken. And when the patient goes to the new place, the patient's expectation, hopes rises, because the person feels, I have come to a new place, here everything will be fine. But after some time, again the patient's hope is crushed, because there also nobody can live up to the patient's expectation. Patient's expectation again being way above the patient's reality. And then there might be some family members who may suggest, let us try some homeo, or let us try some Ayurvedan treatment. Or they may go, there is a, you know, some place, there is one person, there's a Babaji in an ashram, let us go there. So this patient and family go from place to place, all over the place, looking for treatment that does not exist. And as a result, I personally have come across patient and family who have been away from home. They have locked up the home for 6 months. And how did I know about it? Because when I conveyed all of these things, then the patient and family finally were on the same page, and they said, okay, in that case we'll go back. So I thought, okay, I'll just discharge them. But they said, no, we need some more time, because our house is locked for the past 6 months. We'll need at least 4 to 5 days to clean up that house. It is not in a livable condition. So we don't realize that people go from place to place, away from their home, looking for non-existent treatment. And the biggest tragedy of all of this is people sell off their belongings, because they run out of money. They incur debts, and many a times during our home care also we see there are so many patients who have lost their homes and are now living in rented houses, because they can't afford to buy another house after they are sold off everything. And a bigger tragedy of this bankruptcy, of the financial toxicity, is that many of the children of such patients, they drop out of school, and then they miss out on an education, and they slide back a couple of generations, because we understand it is only education that helps children reach a bigger, a higher position than their parents can. But with loss of education, they slide back a couple of generations, and it is so much more difficult to climb back again. So all of these kind of things, this financial toxicity leading to ruin of the whole family without any gain to the patient, all of this happens because of hospital hopping and doctor shopping. And somewhere each one of us are responsible as medical professionals because we have not been communicating bad news to the patient the way we must. Apart from that, the third point is, this is something again which happens very often to most of us, that the family member comes to meet us without the patient and they start crying and they cry a lot in front of us in our consultation room because they never get a chance to cry the way they can cry in our place, because at home the patient is there and in front of the patient they can't really open up. And maybe sometimes when they get overwhelmed, they are not able to control the emotion, they may run out of the house, go to the neighbor's house and cry, but then they have to come back again. Or maybe they are very rich, they live in a palatial house, they may have multiple rooms, so may they run to the furthest room from the patient where the patient is staying. They may run to the furthest room, go into the bathroom, lock the door and cry, and then wash their face and come back in front of the patient and stand there with a plastic smile on their face as if nothing is going on. And this creates a barrier between the patient and family. Now is the time for the family member to hug the patient and say how much they care about this person, but they never get an opportunity to really show the real feelings before the patient dies. The patient may be terminally ill and it may be in that position for weeks or months, but all this time the family members have to do a drama inside the house as if nothing is going on, as if everything is fine. And it's not just the family member who suffers like that. The patient also understands that things are not going well. The patient feels the declining health inside his body. And they understand that something is terribly wrong. They know that people are lying to me. They understand that the doctors are not telling the truth. They understand that the family is not telling the truth. And then they also see relatives from far off places coming to visit them. And they know that something is terribly wrong. They may not know the exact details, but they know something is wrong. And when there are relatives in the house and they're whispering in the next room, they know they're talking about me, but they will not talk to me. So this again creates a barrier. The patient feels isolated. It is like you have been given a big punishment for the crime of getting a bad disease. You have been put up, locked up in isolation. It is like the patient is on this side of a glass barrier. You can see everybody, but there is nobody who is actually on your side. So for the family members, at least they can talk to and cry with other people. For the patient, it's a very, very lonely experience. And this lonely experience continues till actually the patient dies. So this barrier between the patient and family is also that somewhere we are responsible for it, because we have to understand what we are doing by not communicating bad news to the patient, and patient especially, and not making that effort to know, get the skills to communicate bad news to the patient. In palliative care, we know we talk about total care, physical, emotional, social, spiritual, existential. But if we have not spoken to the patient about their bad news, about the poor prognosis, about the reality, or that their life is limited, then what kind of total care can we ever give? If we are never going to get a chance to get into the depths of a person's psyche because we are not being honest with that person, then what kind of total care can we possibly give to such a patient? We can give a lot of superficial care in terms of providing some physical comfort, but that is not good enough. Total care means total care, and that is the USP of palliative medicine. So if we are providing total care, then a big barrier is not communicating bad news to the patient. And remember, I'm talking about those people who want to know. I'm not saying you have to tell, you have to communicate bad news to everybody. You communicate bad news only to those patients who want to know. Next slide. So how do we go on about communicating bad news? First of all, we have to understand the indication. The indication is patient wants to know. Next. So pre-procedure preparation. What do you need to do? You have to update yourself on the patient's medical condition. Even if you are the treating doctor, doesn't matter. You need to go through all the documents that you have, all the reports that you have, the lab report, the scan report, whatever it is. You just have to update yourself on the patient's medical condition. Because the patient may ask something, and then we have to be prepared for all possible information that the patient seeks. So it's always good to update yourself on the patient's medical condition. But if there is something that you don't know, be honest and say, I don't know, but I will find out. But update yourself. Allocate dedicated time for the procedure. You cannot do this in a hurry. You cannot do it between doing something else. You have to allocate time, like a surgeon will allocate time for a certain surgery. You cannot do it, you cannot multitask this communicating bad news. And you have to set the environment. You need to have a place, preferably a quiet place with minimal disturbance, so that a serious discussion, a sensitive and serious discussion, can take place. In my practice, what I usually do is I keep the counseling part, the serious counseling part, late in the evening in my OP area, because by that time most of the doctors would have been finished and most of them would have gone. The number of patients in the OP area would have very much declined. So there is less of noise. There is more peace and quiet. I use that time for serious counseling, like communicating bad news. Next slide. So starting the interview, if you are seeing the person for the first time, you can start by taking the history. It is just like how we have been taught history in our medical colleges. We try to understand the patient. We try to understand where the patient is from, what the patient does, what is the social background, what is the professional background, where are they from, who all they have in the family, etc., etc. Then we get, if we already know it, then we don't have to repeat it. Then we also try to find out the patient's medical history, what happened, and we try to find out from the beginning as to what are the sequence of events. And along with it, we also need to find the patient's insight and concerns. Insight means what the patient understands about what is going on. Many times, if we ask them, why did the doctor ask you to do that investigation? The probably answer that you will get is, well, the doctor asked me to, that's why I did. Because in our culture, we don't ask the doctor, why do you want me to do this investigation? Why do you want me to do this scan? Why do you want me to do this biopsy? Because people feel that you can't ask. So most of the time, our patient may say, I don't know, the doctor asked. So that is the patient's insight. That means there's a blank. There is no information why the doctor asked for a so-and-so investigation. And then you can always ask, okay, then after the reports came, what did the doctor tell you? And the most probably the patient may say something like, they were saying something, I didn't understand what it was. Or they may say, they didn't tell anything, they asked me to come and meet you. Or something like that. Or they may tell you some information, they said that there is some swelling over there, and that is all that I understood. So the patient may either know the real picture, or they may know the partial picture, or they may have a misleading picture of the situation, or they may be total blank about what is going on. So the insight of the patient is very important. At each stage of our history taking, we also need to dig more information to find out what the patient understands. Along with it, we also need to understand what the patient's concerns are. So when they told you that it's a swelling, so what were you thinking? I mean, do you have any concerns about it? So they may come up with, yeah, I don't know how much money I can afford, or I don't know how long I can continue with the treatment. My daughter is not married, or my son is still in school. Whatever, they may have any number of concerns which may or may not be related to the problem at hand. And once we have a clear idea of the patient's history, patient's insights, and the patient's concern, then we have to find out whether the patient wants to know or not. So we can either directly ask them, so what do you want? Do you want to talk about this or something like that? And or the patient may say, so what is wrong with me? What do I have? Etc. So if the patient doesn't ask, you can ask a question. So do you have any question on your mind? Do you have any question for me? Or do you want, what do you want me to talk about? Or something like that. You can give a stimulation to the patient regarding this. My usual way of doing it is that I ask, okay, do you have anything, any question for me? In Malayalam, I say, so basically, do you have any question for me, is how it gets translated. Now, if the patient says, yes, I want to know what is wrong with me, we do not straight away start telling him the problem. We have to first give a warning shot. The warning shot is very important because it gives the patient a chance to move back, to pull back. Once the patient realizes that what the doctor intends to talk about is something serious, then if the patient is not mentally prepared to hear something serious, then the patient has a chance to move back. Next slide. So this is an example of a warning shot. If it is something serious, would you still want to know? In Malayalam, I would say, endengilum serious karyam anengilum ariyanamnundo. In Hindi, I may say, agar kuch serious hai, to kya aap phir bhi janna chahenge? That's about the languages I know, English, Hindi, and Malayalam. So, essentially, it is conveying that it is something serious, would you still want to know? Now you can translate that in your own language and, you know, see how it works for you. Now when we give a warning shot, this is where we are able to discriminate between patients who want to know and who do not want to know. Those who want to know will look you into your eyes and say, yes, I want to know. There will be no confusion. Those who don't want to know may not look you in your eyes. They may look down, or they may look away. They may look up. They may not say anything, but they may not make eye contact. And in our previous session, we talked about the importance of eye contact. You cannot have a communication going on without eye contact. So when somebody is actively not making eye contact, that means the person does not want us to proceed with that communication. Or the patient may change the subject, may say, okay, you give me your medicines and I will come back after 2 weeks. If somebody, or that was just an example. So if somebody is changing the topic, that also means that that person is not prepared, mentally prepared to hear a bad news. Similarly, there may be some patients who may actually tell you, no, I don't want to know. You tell it to my family member or something like that. This is after you give a warning shot. Earlier, they may have said, yes, I want to know. But after you give a warning shot, that if it is something serious, would you still want to know? Then people realize it is something serious. It gives them a chance to back out if they are not mentally prepared. And if they are mentally prepared and they want to know, they will look into your eyes and say, yes. Next slide. So once warning shot has been given, suddenly the atmosphere in the room will change. Till that time, till that point of warning shot, the atmosphere was more relaxed. And the moment warning shot has been given, the atmosphere will become little grim, little more business-like, little more serious. And, you know, in this kind of situation, the patient can either decide that they want to proceed or they don't want to proceed. Please remember, communicating bad news is patient-driven. We are only facilitators. It cannot be our agenda to communicate bad news. It cannot be our agenda how fast we are going to do it. The speed is determined by the patient, and whether the communication will happen or not is determined by the patient. We are only facilitators. And if the patient confirms the desire to know, that is, the person looks into your eyes and says, yes, I want to know, then we have to adopt a narrative approach. Narrative approach is storytelling. You tell a story of the patient to the patient from the beginning. Next slide. So you narrate the story of the patient to the patient from the beginning. Even though you have been having a conversation with this patient for the past couple of days, but when you're talking about communicating bad news, you tell the story of the patient to the patient from the beginning. For example, 3 months ago, you had some cough and weight loss and you went to the local doctor. The local doctor gave you some medicines. Those were antibiotics and some vitamins. And after taking them for 1 week, you did not have much of a relief. So the doctor asked you to get a chest X-ray done. So you're telling the patient why the doctor asked you to get a chest X-ray done. So that is a chunk of information. So we give small chunks of information by filling in the blanks, the patients in the blank spots of the patient's insight. So you are telling the story of the patient to the patient, and many of the part the patient knows, but there are some parts that the patient doesn't know that you have found out by digging up the patient's insight while you were taking the history. And the blank spot you fill by giving a chunk of information. So, for example, the X-ray showed something like a shadow. And when you have given a new information, you find out the patient's body language. Is the patient making eye contact? If the patient is making eye contact, continue the story forward. And then to find out what the shadow was, next slide, they sent you to the city hospital, and then they did a scan to find out what the shadow was, right? So you also have to gradually escalate the information that you are giving. For example, something like a shadow in the X-ray becomes shadow to find out what is wrong. So they sent you to do a CT scan. In the CT scan, they found something like a tumor. And to find out what this tumor was, they did a biopsy. So something like a shadow becomes shadow, and shadow becomes something like a tumor. Something like a tumor becomes tumor, and tumor becomes something like a cancer, and something like a cancer becomes cancer. So gradually, as the story moves forward, you fill in the blanks by giving chunks of information, and every chunk will be giving more information than the previous chunk. So gradually you will escalate information, and while you're escalating information, focus on the patient's body language. The moment patient cuts off eye contact, you pause the story over there. Because when the patient is not making eye contact, that means they are trying to digest this new information that they are receiving. And if there is too much of new information, they can't process it while continuing eye contact. So they will break eye contact to process this new information that they are getting. And if they are breaking eye contact, you just pause the story. You just pause the narrative till they come back by making eye contact and asking, okay, then what? Or something like that. Then you continue the story. There is a possibility that it may be a long pause, that is that they are not making eye contact. You're also sitting there not knowing whether you want to proceed, whether you can proceed or not. It can be a little bit of an uncomfortable situation if the patient is not making eye contact and you don't know. You're in the middle of the story and you don't know what to do. In that kind of a situation, you can always ask, should I proceed? Do you want me to tell you more? And at that point of time, if the patient does not make eye contact, that means probably the patient had enough of information for the time. Or the patient may say, okay, I'll come back later. That means the patient is changing the topic. That also means the patient had enough for the time. Or the patient says, I had enough, we'll talk about it later, or something like that. Then also it is very clear that the patient, until and unless the patient looks into your eyes and gives you permission to proceed, till that time you proceed. But the moment that patient indicates that the person had enough, you do not give more information. So this is how we find out whether the patient wants to know or not, by giving a warning shot and then narrating the story of the patient to the patient by giving chunks of information and escalating the information as you move along, till a point where the patient says or is indicating non-verbally that the patient had enough. Or the other option would be that you have the patient gives you permission to give the full information till that point. Next slide. So this is what I was talking about. The story can be finished either in the middle of the story or in the end of the story. The patient decides how much the patient wants to know. Our job is to give information as much as the patient wants to know. Our usual practice is we tell them the full information. You have cancer, it's all this, that, this position, that position, etc. This can be done and this can't be done. So the individualized disclosure model does not work like that. We first find out the person in front of you wants to know or not. And if the patient wants to know, then we give information only as much as the patient wants. This has an inbuilt protective mechanism, because you do not harm those who do not want to know, and you do not harm those who want to know by giving excess information, more information than they want. So it is a built-in safety mechanism by ensuring that we do not harm people with information that they don't want to know. And once they get to know enough information that they want, be prepared for an emotional reaction. Whether you have completed the story or not, be prepared for emotional reaction, because what you have told them has altered their perception of their future, about their life forever. However nicely you may say, it is a very traumatic experience to any person. So be prepared for an emotional reaction, and sometimes rarely there may be no reaction also. No reaction can be either because the person is so numb, cannot think. That could be a reason, or the person was expecting, already knew this, was expecting, just wanted a confirmation from some authority, and you have confirmed it. And the person says, I always knew this. So in those kind of situations, there may not be any reaction, but be prepared for a reaction in the form of crying. There may be anger. It could be a combination of a lot of unpleasant emotions, but it is important to allow the people to ventilate that emotion. Next slide. And when people ventilate emotion, just be quiet and stay there. Don't give them advices at that point of time. Don't give encouraging news. Don't say, we are there, everything will be fine. No. Don't say anything, just be there. And if you have a good enough relationship, touch them. Because at that point of time, it is very important to don't be a doctor, be a human being at that point of time with another human being who has just been told a very bad news. Don't do something, just be there. Till their emotion is totally ventilated. Most of the time when people start crying or you know, getting distressed, our instinct is to say some nice words, trying to soothe them. That doesn't help because it will only bottle up their emotion. It's very important to allow the emotion to be ventilated. It will not take too much time. Many people are under the impression that it will take a lot of time. No. Just be there with them. Don't say a word. Just allow them to cry and get it over with. It will not take too much time. A minute or two is the usual time. But be there. Don't run away. Don't say anything. Just be there. Next slide. Once the emotional reaction has subsided, the patient may themselves ask some questions, or you could ask whether the patient wants to know anything more. Sometimes the patient may say, how much time do I have? Please remember, when people are asking after an emotional outburst, when people are asking how much time do I have, don't give them the medical statistics. Ask them, why do they ask? Why are they asking? Why are they saying what they're saying? At that point of time, giving statistics is not important. Understanding why they're asking is important. At that point of time, they may come up with, because my son's wedding is due, or my daughter is joining engineering college, or I have so and so issues coming up. And it is very important to allow people to come up with what they have in their mind. When people say that, you know, I'm feeling so scared, I'm so upset, or, you know, how much time do I have? They may have a reason for saying that. And most of the time, when we understand why they are saying what they are saying, most of the time we understand we don't have a solution to offer. We can't get their daughter married off. We can't get their son's education done. We can't do most of the things that our patients and families are facing. We are, after all, just medical professionals. We have very limited things that we can offer. But what we can do is giving them a chance to ventilate, listening to them, and that is very, very therapeutic. Whether you have something to offer medically or not, listening to them, that active listening, is very, very therapeutic. Now, that is something that we need to get trained in, that not to do something, to sit and listen. And remember, it is not a waste of time. It is a kind of therapy. It's a very, very powerful therapy, allowing the patients to talk about themselves. And sometimes they may ask us questions that we may have answers to. And if we know that answers, give clear and honest answers. Don't beat around the bush. And if you don't know, you tell them, I don't know. That is also being honest. And you don't end up by just saying, I don't know. You tell them, I'll try to find out. Or I'll direct you to somebody who probably knows about it. So it is very, very important to be honest about your dealing with somebody with whom you have communicated bad news. Next slide. The don'ts. Do not give false hope. That is the worst thing you can do to a human being, giving them false hopes. But do give achievable hopes. Many a times when patients are referred to us in an advanced stage of malignancy, multiple metastasis, stage 4 disease, performance status 4, and in that kind of conditions, we honestly tell them that, you know, that they are declining because the disease is getting out of control. But after all those things, we also tell them, I will make sure that you will not suffer till the end point of your life. Now, that is something that you learn in palliative medicine, that you can ensure that a person does not have to suffer in pain or breathlessness or restlessness or delirium. These are the things that we can really control. They are not just words of assurance. They are the achievable things that we tell them. And we give them clear-cut guidelines, clear plans of what to do, when to do, how to come for review, when to get admitted, when not to get admitted, etc., etc., etc. Just because somebody has a terminal disease does not mean there is nothing to do. There is plenty to do. There is plenty to do, but it is important to understand not to give false hope, but to give achievable hopes and give a clear-cut plans of how we are going to achieve and maintain it. And needless to say, it is a participatory decision-making. It is not my way or the highway. It is a discussion where the patient's views and the family's views are given due weightage. Next slide. Once you have clarified all of that, the plan is made, then ask for any clarification or any doubts that the patient or the family may still have after all the discussion, and close the interview by leaving the door open. Give them a contact number. If you don't want to give your personal mobile number, don't give, but give them some kind of a contact number and tell them you are most welcome to contact this number for any of your needs till we are going to meet after 2 weeks. In between, if you need to contact us, have this number. Give them some number. Next slide. Post-procedure follow-up. If the patient is your inpatient, before you go home, please visit the patient. You can just tell them, I just came over to see how you are doing. You don't have to pretend that you came for rounds. And they actually really appreciate the doctor coming over just to see how they are. And if you are busy and you can't, allocate one of your team members. Need not be a doctor, it could be a social worker, it could be a nurse, it could be anybody. But allocate somebody to go and check up on the patient and the family, that how they are coping up. If you have done this on an OP basis, give them a call or arrange for somebody to give them a call in late evening just to check up on them on how they are doing. This creates a bond. This creates a trust. It creates a sense that this person cares for me. And in the process, it is possible that they may have some doubt, which will also be a good opportunity to clarify such doubts. Next slide. Okay, go back. So this is where our communicating bad news ends. When we do workshops, we have a session where the participants get a chance to role play in communicating bad news. So when you actually do it, this standard operating procedure makes more sense. But you can try doing this at your places. And if there is a workshop coming up in Palim India or somewhere else, please do participate in it, because this skill of how to communicate bad news is a very, very important skill. And not just for people who are working in palliative medicine, in palliative care field, this is an important skill across the board. The next topic is pollution management. And Rajeshmi, Sunil, what do I do? Should I begin with questions or should I proceed with pollution?
Please proceed and try to finish as early as possible.
Yeah, pollution is a very small topic. It's a big problem, but it's a small presentation. Pollution is basically when, in our context, when a family member comes to us and says, please do not tell it to the patient. I'm sure most of you would have experiences where the family member comes and says, please do not tell it to the patient. There is also possibility that the patient may sometimes come and says, please do not tell it to my wife, please do not tell it to my children, and so on and so forth. So essentially, collusion is a conspiracy of silence where two parties collude to keep the information away from the third party. In our culture, the usual two parties are the family and the medical professional, and we keep the third party away, that is the patient. Now, why do the family members do it? Because they are trying to protect their loved one. From whom? From us. Why? Because they are scared that we may tell their loved one the bad news and as a result harm them. But the irony is they need our help also. And they need our help, but they are also very afraid of us. So that is why they come to us and beg us, please don't tell their loved ones. Next slide. So, many of us, those who advocate communicating bad news, when we have a family member who is coming and becoming an obstruction, we try to make them understand that it is very important to communicate bad news to the patient. But my suggestion is, do not do it at this point of time. When the family member has come to you and requesting you not to tell, please remember, they must be so anxious. And when people are in a high state of emotion, then trying to reason with them at the intellectual level does not work, will not succeed. So you have to get their anxiety down. You have to get the high emotional stress down. And the simplest way of doing that is to agree to collude by acknowledging that, you know, the fear exists, acknowledging that they must be so anxious that somebody may tell their loved one the bad news. Next slide. And do not challenge their belief system. They may believe that the moment you tell the bad news, their loved one will die of a heart attack. You may, as a medical professional, say, oh, that is not possible. His coronary angiogram is perfectly fine. This person is not going to get a heart attack. But that is not the point. They believe that this will happen. And when we challenge people's belief, their anxiety only increases. So it is very important not to increase their anxiety, reduce their anxiety by accepting that they are so anxious and also promising them that you will not tell them. Next slide. So basically, you agree to collude in the beginning. You agree to collude. You agree that they don't want us to tell the patient. You say, okay, I will not tell. And you can also ask the family, what have you told your loved one? And the family may say, oh, we have told him that it is just an ulcer. It will go away in 2 months' time, etc., etc. So you can say, okay, I will also say the same thing. So when you agree not to disclose the bad news to the patient, this will reduce the anxiety of the family a lot. They may not still trust you, but at least their anxiety comes down. And now it is our job to win the trust of the family by agreeing and, you know, demonstrating that you have not broken the promise. So you can go and see the patient, you can, you know, give medicines to relieve their pain or breathlessness or whatever, and then you can continue having a build up of relationship with the family. Next slide. And this may take a couple of meetings for you to, you know, talk to the family, listen to what their needs are, listen to what their concerns are, and listening to their concerns and talking to them and finding solutions to their concerns and not creating a problem is all, these are the ways you will be able to win the trust of the family. If you are very skillful, you may be able to win the trust of the family in the very first meeting, or at least we must try to win the trust of the family in the first or second meeting. Meanwhile, if the patient asks, what is wrong with me? I want to know. Then you are in a bit of a trouble because the family is telling you don't tell and the patient is demanding to know. In that kind of a situation, you may have to buy some time by telling the patient that I don't have all the information. I'm looking for all the reports, etc., etc. You give me some time before I can study the problem, and only then I can give you some information. So you buy some time. Meanwhile, next slide. You start working on the family or the on the colludos. These are the same points which I told you when I was telling you about communicating bad news. Why? It is important to communicate bad news. So once you have the trust of the family, you can start discussing these points with the family members so that it will make them think that yes, there is a point in it. That if this hospital hopping and doctor shopping and all the stress that is creating is because we have not told him or her. And they will also understand that if the person wanted to do something, they want to finish some of their things, they get a chance only now. The more you delay, the chance is gone. So all of these things, the topics that we talked about in communicating bad news, you can bring in front of the patient, not in the first meeting, perhaps not in the second meeting, the moment you realize that you have a very trustworthy relationship which has developed between you and the family. Then you can bring these topics and orient the family towards these topics. Next slide. And please remember, when you are trying to convince the family, do not push beyond the point, because there is a possibility that some family members will never agree. So if you push beyond a point, then there is a possibility that they may get angry and take the patient away from you. So whatever good you could have done for the patient without communicating bad news, those opportunity will also go. For example, you were able to give good pain control, good control of breathlessness. Those things you can do even if the collusion is maintained, right? It becomes a little difficult if the patient's demand to know and the family is continuing to obstruct it. It's a bit of a delicate balance you have to play, but these skills will come, over a period of time. And those who are experienced otherwise, they may already have that skill of balancing the patient's demand and the family's contradictory demands. So be prepared for failures, but failing in managing collusion is not shameful, but not trying to manage collusion definitely is not desirable. You must try to manage collusion so that we get the chance to reach out to the patient and communicate bad news. I think that is the last slide.
Okay. So thank you, Biju. We have beyond our time. So are there any questions? We can have one or two questions.
I think last time when we were doing the first part, there were some participants who had questions related to these today's topics. I hope you have got the answers to the questions that you had in your mind. And if there is any further clarification you need, I'll be happy to provide it.
Dr. Veena?
I think, sir, we should forget that we are doctors and become a family member for the entire session. Then only we can succeed. That's my feeling.
Madam, we continue to be human beings. We were born human beings. We will die as human beings. We just learned the skill of medical profession.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Most welcome, madam. There are no questions, probably. I know that you are running behind schedule, but in case there are no questions, probably please go ahead.
Sir,
sir,
one question, sir. So what happens, I mean, it's just an example, if a patient with HIV comes to you, I mean, we have diagnosed him, and he doesn't want his family members to know it only because of the stigma, sir. So we have to respect his autonomy, but at the same time, we are in concern also. So how do we go about this communication?
Sunil, you have some experience with this kind of situation?
This was one of the questions which we had from participants of previous echo. So it is important for the wife or spouse to know about the status, because it is going to affect the spouse also. So first of all, you have to talk to the patient itself, and then tell him why it is important to to disclose the diagnosis and things like that to the spouse. And this will take some time. But if the patient is not in favor of disclosing diagnosis, I think as we have to tell the wife even without the permission of the patient, because it is going to be a problem for the wife otherwise. So in such situation, I think autonomy need not be respected, because it is going to cause severe or life-threatening problem for the other person.
Thank you.
Dr. Priya asked, what happens if there is a conflict of interest? Relatives fighting over will or money. So how to deal, especially if patient is in no condition to make a decision?
I guess any kind of communication in serious matters is never a one-way street. It is always negotiation. It is trying to understand the point of view of various stakeholders in the situation, and we trying to give them a kind of a synopsis of the situation, and you know, generating a consensus. And while we are doing this, we have to ensure that we do not get involved within the internal family politics. That is very important. You always remember that we are care providers, and we have to provide care first in the best interest of the patient, and secondly in the best interest of the family. It is very normal that there will be family politics in any scenario, but we have to stay away from that, adopt a very, very neutral situation, even if people who are very close to us over a period of time ask our opinion on what should we do regarding these kind of things, we have to very clearly say that this is an internal matter of your family. I am sorry, I cannot make a comment on that. Because the moment you appear to take a side of any party, then you are drawn into battle, and this is preferably, I mean, you not preferably, this has to be avoided, but you have to be available for any kind of suggestion or any kind of negotiation in the best interest of the patient and the family. Please, anybody else has any additional points to add, Sunil, or anybody else over there, please feel free to add to it.
I think we will move on to the patient story. So today the patient story will be presented by Dr. Arjun, who is a palliative care physician at Palliam India. The today's guest presentation was by some of the participants from your because of some problem, he was unable to present. So Dr. Arjun will be presenting the patient story.
Hello everyone. So today we'll be talking about a 39-year-old male whose diagnosis is traumatic paralysis with stage 4 pressure sore on sacral region and left gluteal region. So he was presented with complaints of constipation since 2 days and bed sore over sacral region and gluteal region. Also moderate pain over the hip region and urinary leakage. About the history of his illness, he had a history of fall while carrying weight, followed by neck pain and weakness of both limbs, and was diagnosed with traumatic quadriceps in August 2015. He was admitted and got treatment from one of the government hospital and was discharged after 1 month. After 6 months, he developed a bed sore over the sacral and gluteal region, which was stage 4, and there was history of pain over the hip and wound side for more than 2 weeks. Pain over the hip region, it is 5 out of 10, intermittent burning type of pain bilaterally, and at the wound side, it was 4 out of 10, continuous throbbing type of pain. Due to this, sometimes they keep the wound open. And he also had a disturbed sleeping pattern and decreased oral intake. On examination, he was conscious and oriented. His temperature was 98 degrees Fahrenheit, pulse 82 beats per minute, respiration 22 breaths per minute, BP was 120 by 70 millimeters of mercury, and all systems were within normal limits. Regarding the pressure source, there were warmth and tenderness, exudates were present, tunneling was present, they were irregular in shape and foul smelling. The treatment and significant investigations, routine investigations were done, and the hemoglobin was 10, total count 34,000, 80%, lymphocytes 18, eosinophils 2%, platelet 1.6 lakhs per microliter. Serum creatinine was 0.9 milligram per deciliter. Serum sodium was 132 and potassium 4. Regarding psychosocial aspects, he is a 39-year-old unmarried man living with a 65-year-old mother in a rented house. He has one sibling and he is married and living separately and not caring or helping them. He was a manual laborer and was the breadwinner of his family. Now his mother is manual laborer and she is taking care of him. The main source of income now is from mother's daily wages, her pension and some of his friends. They have taken rupees 1.5 lakhs from private finance bank for the treatment purpose. He is a devout Christian, now unable to go to church. This makes him very sad. He communicates through cell phone and he says to his mother like, "I don't think I can walk, so please don't spend any money over my treatment." So the main concerns are pressure sore, pain and financial problems. Coming to the summary, is a 39-year-old man with traumatic quadriceps paralysis with bedsore present over sacral and left gluteal region, stage 4, with pain over the hip region. So the discussion points: do we need to provide palliative care for this patient? What are the problems faced by this patient? And what all can be done for this patient and his mother? Thank you.
Thank you, Arjun. So we have a 39-year-old patient who is diagnosed with a traumatic quadriceps paralysis, and he has pressure sore stage 4 and has pain. So the questions are, do we need to provide palliative care for this patient? What are the problems faced by this patient? And what all can be done for this patient and his mother? So anybody can comment any of the questions? Dr. Narendra.
Yes, we need to take this patient for palliation because he is in chronic pain, number one. Number two, he has infected ulcers over his sacrum and needs a lot of nursing care and a regular nursing supervision. Third thing is, he has also gone down on eating. That is, the nutrition level is also going down. And the TC, that is the 34,000 count is there, shows that a lot of infection is there. So when such type of things are presented, and all the vitals are normal, so it is an accidental trauma. Otherwise, his whole other systems are functioning. Only due to pressure he is getting these ulcers. So once we treat the ulcers by, for example, giving an alpha 1 bed, and then by regularly taking up the exercise, counseling her mother to help them in the care provider in nursing, involve her, make her to do the nursing, because the urine is all, they said that urine is also dribbling. So that we need to put a condom catheter or some sort of which, because it will spoil the wound. The debridement should be done. And in the pain management, the physician roles comes in, starts with nanopoid, and then go with morphine in the last, the third stage in the last. And in the history, he is not having good sleep pattern. It should also be corrected. His nutrition should be addressed by mouth only, and oral medication may be immediately started because all other systemic functions are good. So it is a very good case for palliation, and then proper counseling should be taken to her mother, and mother should be able to do the nursing care with our nurse. So yes, all these things coming into factor, this case is a very good case for palliation. Because he is a young person, he has still a lot of life to go. Then once this pressure source are being addressed, then he can be provided with trained for other movements and other therapies, where he can be again wheelchaired and his quality of life will be improved. That is my opinion.
Thank you, Dr. Narendra. Dr. Veena. Vishnu, please unmute Dr. Veena. Madam, please wait. Let's unmute him. Yeah.
We have to increase his positive attitude by maybe saying, telling him the story of Stephen Hawking or something like that. And he will really be able to be a social citizen, because these are all superficial and his complex has gone down. We have to bring up counseling and increasing his positive attitude will help a lot. Thank you.
Yeah. So this patient doesn't have a cancer, but this patient is suffering from a serious health related suffering. So any patient with serious health related suffering requires palliative care. So this patient needs palliative care. So what are the problems? Dr. Narendra has narrated many problems. So are there any other problems faced by this patient and family?
he said he is a spiritual person. He likes to go to church and all that. So maybe we can involve the community to visit his home and, you know, make him happy.
So he and his mother is living together, and there are many problems because there are nobody to visit them. One of the sibling, he does not care the patient, and there are financial problems because the patient is unable to go for any job. Dr. Priya says economic constraints. So these are some of the issues which we can manage by involving the community. And for the pressure sore, so after controlling the infection, will it be possible to do a flap surgery so that patient can move in a wheelchair, and even he can go to the church, so that some of his spiritual pain can be relieved? Are there anybody else? What needs to be done for Dr. Ham?
It's basically, I feel that this person needs little bit of management on the bed sore side, but more of nursing care and psychological handling, because now we see there are enough institutions and enough organizations where you have paraplegics having almost a normal life. Now, since this fellow is a quadriplegic, but there are enough diseases like multiple sclerosis and congenital myopathy patients who are being taken care by proper counseling and proper wheelchairs. Mm-hmm. So maybe this person needs a little bit of medical angle initially to take care of the bed sore and the urinary incontinence and nursing care, and more focus needs to come from some social support or some social organization helping him out, providing a wheelchair and, you know, getting him back with a positive attitude, as ma'am said initially, you know, giving example of Stephen Hawking. I mean, this person, as he has told his mother that don't spend money on me, I will not be able to walk. He probably needs an attitude change, because I mean, there are so many people who may not be able to walk, but they have their life going on.
Yeah, thank you. Bichu. Bichu.
Any questions in front of you? Do we need to provide palliative care? Yes, no doubt. Problems faced by the patient is perhaps in all the realms of suffering. There is a physical pain, there's emotional pain, there's a social pain, financial pain, and spiritual / existential pain. And as I concur with what the participant has said, we need to provide excellent pain relief. And persistent and good nursing care. It's not enough for a nurse to visit once a month. It is important that we, if the palliative care team over there can ensure at least a weekly visit, so that the family can be taught how to do. But we just don't, you know, just abandon them. We do a weekly visit, do it for them, and also ensure that the quality control is there. That, you know, if we are not following up, it's very easy for the family to, you know, gradually slip on the quality of care. And yes, involve the community, because many a times when we have patients who are quadriplegic or, for that matter, paraplegic, they just confine themselves within the four walls of the home, and it's very important to involve the community so that the sense of loneliness is taken away. It also is demotivating if you feel alone, nobody cares for you. And if we want to rehabilitate them physically, we first need to get them motivated at the upper level. So it is very important to get them motivated so that they feel they are self-motivated for rehabilitation. Remember, rehabilitation is very hard on the patient and on the family, but more so on the patient. You need to maintain the motivation. And as Dr. Hima was saying, there are plenty of people with paraplegias who are, you know, living their own lives. And why not quadriplegics too? So within the physical limitations, we have to encourage people to live their lives. Doesn't matter what their bodies are. And yeah, I kind of agree with all the points that have come up. And palliative care is the sum total of all of that. And this involves taking care of the patient, the mother. Everybody is suffering in that environment. Yeah.
So one more thing is many patients who are quadriparetic or paraparetic, they live a very independent life. So if we can form such a group, and there will be many people who can motivate this type of persons, so that they will understand how the another person has gone through difficulties, and from their experiences they have a lot to learn, so that they can also overcome. That will be motivating for them. Dr. Hema, 1 minute, madam. Yeah.
That we can make a group. I think there are enough groups already existing. I can't give a reference right now, but all these the special sports of the specially abled people, I came across, I think in KBC also, there were people who have who are paraplegics, and they have their organization, NGOs, who are picking up people like this only and visiting them only for psychological. I mean, they're not doing any medical part. They're just picking them up and giving them psychological support and bringing them back to the normal, whatever normal life they can lead. Mm-hmm. So the groups are already there. Like, I don't know how many are involved with us, but it's just a matter of finding out.
Yeah. So we have a group of paraplegics and they have a WhatsApp group, and even they physically visit the patients, and so that their relations are maintained, and they exchange ideas and things like each other. So I think if any of you have any more questions regarding communicating bad news or collusion, we can discuss now. Dr. Veena?
Regarding that HIV question that was taken up just before time, medico-legally, will we be right if the husband doesn't want to tell the wife, but because of the other considerations, we tell the life, tell the truth to the wife. What would be our position medico-legally?
We should first, we'll be trying to convince the patient to disclose the diagnosis. Even then, I had a talk with some of the people who was involved in HIV care. And they say there is a court order saying it can be done. If the patient is not willing, it can be disclosed to the spouse, considering their safety.
Thank you, sir. I think these things should be highlighted, because we doctors, you know, we many a time we slip on the medico-legal things and we suffer. I think these things, these points wherein how to protect ourselves medico-legally should be highlighted. Thank you.
Any more questions? Vijay, do you have anything more to add?
Yes, sir. Please, can you unmute from your end, sir?
Vijay, please unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
Nothing much that to be added. It's already time, but I guess what Dr. Veena is saying, that there are some of those medical legal issues, especially related to end of life care. Probably ECHO project should consider having a session on that kind of issue also.
Yeah, we are planning to have that on end of life care session.
So you'll be discussing the medical legal aspects also?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So, Prina madam, you are going to have one more great session concerning medical legal issues and our as doctors, how we can keep ourselves safe and protected.
It will be concentrated on withholding or withdrawing life support issues mainly.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think we will close the session today. And thank you, Vijay, for joining us and having two important session done for us. And thank you, all of you. And thanks. I would thank Dr. Arjun because he presented the patient story with a short notice.
Yeah, that was. I was also going to say that my congratulations to Dr. Arjun. In a very short notice, he presented a very good case. So just convey my appreciation to him.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. So thank you all for joining in. So I've shared the feedback link. So give